What's up everyone? This week it's WWDC, so there won't be a regular video, and instead I want to share with you what are my highlights of WWDC announcements so far. And I'm not going to talk about the features that have been announced during WWDC's keynote, because these announcements, they are more aimed at a mainstream audience. And instead, I'm going to tell you about the features that have been announced during the platform State of the Union, which is basically like a second keynote, but focused on features aimed at developers. So let's get started with a big new addition to Swift called Swift Async Algorithms. Up until now, whenever we needed to use a complex asynchronous algorithm, like for instance combining two asynchronous sequences, the default approach was to use the combine framework. But that's no longer the case, because as you can see in this code snippet, now Swift comes with built-in async operators, like for instance the zip operator right here. And one of the big advantages of this new async algorithm is that they work with Swift built-in async await syntax, which is arguably easier to read and write than combined closure-based APIs. Next, we have the announcement of distributed actors. Actors were introduced to Swift during last year's WWDC, and they're basically the thread-safe equivalent of a class. And this year, Swift introduces distributed actors, which seem to offer the same level of thread safety, but this time also across different processes and even across network calls. And I can tell you, I'm really excited to dig more into this feature, as it seems to definitely have a lot of potential. Next, we have the introduction in Swift of a literal syntax for regular expressions. And what's particularly nice is that this new literal syntax seems to also be type safe, which means that the compiler will be able to check our regular expressions for potential mistakes. And given how regular expressions tend to very quickly become very complex, just as you can see in this example right here, Swift also comes with a new regex builder syntax. You can see an example of it right here, and it allows us to build a regex piece by piece, just like we would build a Swift UI view. Then we have exciting new announcements regarding generics. Up until now, writing code that relied on protocols with assets types, like the collection protocol for instance, would result in that kind of very verbose function signatures. But that's no longer going to be the case, because Swift now supports opaque parameter types. So just like we could use the keyword sum in the return type of a function or of a property, think for instance of SwiftUI's body property, we can now also use the keyword sum with the argument of a function. And as you can see, doing so allows us to get rid of quite some boilerplate. And another very exciting new feature regarding protocols is that the any keyword now finally allows us to use protocol with asserted types as the actual type of a variable. So here we no longer need to introduce a generic type that we need to constrain to the protocol collection. We can directly use the protocol collection with the any keyword to type our property playlists. And when put together, these two new features allow us to write that kind of generic code with the minimum amount of boilerplate. Next, we have the introduction of Swift plugin package, which offer a way to embed a command line tool inside the Swift package. Think for instance of tools like SwiftLint, SwiftFormat, or Sorcery. For now, they run as independent command line tools, but now we'll be able to embed them inside a Swift plugin package and basically execute them directly inside Xcode. After that, we had a lot of exciting new additions to SwiftUI. So I picked three of them. The first one is the introduction of the navigation stack. SwiftUI's navigation view had always been under a lot of criticism, and this year it has actually been officially deprecated. And instead, Apple introduced navigation stack, which is basically a much more flexible API to implement the navigation of a SwiftUI app. As you can see, a navigation stack works with a path to which we're going to append new path components as we navigate further inside the structure of our app. I only took a quick look at code samples, but I'm pretty excited with this new path property, because it basically makes it much easier to implement a programmatic navigation. So implementing deep links for SwiftUI apps should be much easier now. It's also worth noting that navigation link has been greatly improved. The big downside of navigation link was that it forced us to immediately implement the destination view, which resulted in views being tightly coupled together. But that's no longer the case, because we have this new navigation destination modifier, which basically allows us to extract the destination of a navigation link. The interoperability API between SwiftUI and UIKit has also been improved. Up until now, we had at our disposal UI hosting controller, which would enable us to embed a SwiftUI view inside a UIKit UI view controller. And now we also have UI hosting configuration, which we can see as some kind of a lightweight UI hosting controller. and this should make it easier to either use a UI collection view inside a Swift UI app or to start embedding simple Swift UI views inside the cells of a UIKit app. And finally, Swift UI now comes with a new framework called Swift Charts to display data in the form of a beautiful chart. Up until recently, I was actually working on banking apps, and I definitely remember that implementing that kind of chart used to take a lot of time. So this is definitely a great addition for any kind of app that needs to display data to the user. And finally, the last addition I wanted to tell you about is the introduction of Passkey, which is basically a passwordless sign-in system integrated directly inside iOS. I didn't have the time to look into the specifics of how this feature works, but from what I could see in the demo, it seems to rely on private keys being securely generated and stored inside the secure enclave. But what really gets me excited with this feature is how it vastly manages to improve and simplify the sign-in process. And this seems to be especially true whenever we need to sign in onto an external device, because it seems to be as simple as scanning a QR code with our phone and then validating the login using Face ID. And if you ever had of following the very tedious process of, for instance, logging into your streaming app on your smart TV using the remote of the TV, I think you understand why I'm pretty excited about this feature. And that's it. These were my highlights from the platform State of the Union that I wanted to share with you. Of course, I definitely didn't cover everything that has been announced during the State of the Union. So if you want to go and watch the video by yourself, you will find the link in the description. Finally, if there is any new feature being announced this week that you would like me to cover in a future video, please let me know in the comments. Thank you for watching the video. Have a great WWDC and see you next time.